Welcome to this video about the topic MBS Thinkit. My name is Stefanie Juchmes. The presentation was intended for the SOJO conference in America. Because this conference is cancelled, I would like to share the information about Thinkit with you in this video. This presentation will give you an instruction to the topic Thinkit. I will show you what you can do with Thinkit and what you have to expect about this topic in the next plugin version. Here are some facts about me. I was born in 1992 and I'm actually 27 years old. 2018 I graduated with a Bachelor of Science degree in the University of Bonn. I study computer science and since January 2019 I work for Monkeybread Software that supplies the MBS plugins. The MBS SOJO plugins consist of 40 different plugins. We have more than 65,000 items in the documentation. It's a huge toolbox that you can use for your projects. I want to introduce today only one topic of the MBS Mac 64-bit plugin, the Thinkit. But at first, what is Thinkit? Thinkit is a powerful graphic engine that based on the Apple Thinkit framework that using the Metal engine for 3D graphics. The topic includes 49 classes and have 858 entries for the work with Thinkit. At first I show you how you can prepare a normal scene and what we need for that. At first we add a Thinkit control to the window. We find it in the library. Then we add two properties. My scene is Thinkit Scene MBS and my view as Thinkit View MBS. At next we open the open event of the Thinkit control and add these lines. At first we connect the property my view with the view of the control. After that we initialize my scene as a new instance of the Thinkit scene class. And then we set the scene of my view to this scene. Then we want some default light in our view. Because of this, we activate the default light of the scene. We will talk about light extensively later. Then we want to switch the camera view by trackpad, so we allow the camera control. Also, you can choose a background color for our scene. Black is a good choice because colors seem very bright and full on a black background. Now let's talk about base geometries. We have a lot of basic forms that you can use in your scene and can combine it. So we start with a sphere. I want to show you in this example how you can implement it. At first we define the radius of the sphere to decide the size of the object. Then we initialize a new instance of the Thinkit sphere class with a given radius. Then we set the segment count property of our sphere. I want to show you the difference between different segment counts. The segment count is the count of the vertices lines of an object. The higher you select the segment count, the smoother is your surface. With a segment count of 4, you can see it has 4 edges. And with higher solution, you split off these edges. The more vertices a project has, the greater the computing effort is. Then back to the code, we create a new node object with the information of our sphere. But what is a node and how does it work? Our scene is working with a node system that looks like a tree. We have a root node in our scene. That is the first node in the tree, on which all other nodes are connected in different levels. The root node exists exactly once in a view. The other nodes are children of the root node. A node can be a parent of an other node. But what means that? If you have move a parent node, you automatically move the child node too. If you move the child node, the parent didn't move. If you move a parent node with more than one future level, All notes of this branch will move in the scene. Here is the mnemonic. If a young child's parents move, the child moves too. But if the child moves, the parents inconclusively move. Then we want to find a position for the sphere in this view. All positions are given by a 3D coordinate system. We have three axes, x, epsilon and z. X is the high axis, epsilon the axis that gives us left and right, and the z axis gives us the fore and back position. In the coordinate system, we have a point with 0, 0, 0. This is the origin of the coordinate system and the default insert value for a node. All axes can have positive and negative values. So, for example, we have a sphere in the default position in the origin. If we want to move left and right, we must change the x values. If we want to go to the right, we have positive values, and if we go to the left, we got negative values. Normally, the origin of any object is located in the center of the object. The pyramid is an exception. Its center of gravity is in the middle of the base plate. This is what we have to consider when positioning the objects in a scene. Now we want to take a look to the other base forms. We defined a torus by its ring radius and pipe radius. Then the plane we defined with width and height. Then we have the constructor of the pyramid with width, height and length. Then we have the floor form. It is a plane with infinity length and width. It has also a property that allows you to set the intensity of the reflections. The cylinder is defined by its radius and height. In the case of the cone form, we define the radius of the upper surface and the lower surface, as well as the height. Its result is a truncated cone. If we define the upper radius as 0, we get a perfect cone. The capsule is a basic form, could also be assembled from two spheres and a cylinder. So it is not surprising that for the creation of this basic form, the radius of the capsule tip and the height of the capsule is needed. For the box, we have the normal parameters with width, height and length. Additionally, we have another parameter where we can specify how much our corners should be rounded. Extremely sharp edges makes an animation unnatural. Look at a dice, for example. Its corners are rounded too. Then we have the tube. The tube is defined by an inner radius, an outer radius and height. The inner cylinder is subtracted by the outside cylinder, so we got this form. Then we come to text. We define the text with the parameters text and the depth of the text. Then we can set the other properties, to examples, to smooth the edges of the text. The text is very similar to the basic forms and is added to the scene in the same way. Then we come to the category material. The category material is about color and the surface structure. The material is essential for the look of an animation, because there is a big difference between the look of a sparkling metal ball and a rough stone ball. Also, they have the same shape and the same size. I want to show you some of the possibilities to model material. At first, we start with the colors. You have variants of colors you can choose. The most easiest way is to take some of the default colors from the color class. Here you see how to define a color in the first material property of the geometry node. As default colors, we have black, blue, brown, cyan, green, three shades of gray, dark gray and light gray, magenta, orange, purple, red, white, and yellow. And then we have system colors, which are a bit different in the color tone. You can also work with color spaces. For example, you can use the HSV color space. In this case, we have four values for a color. At first, the color angel, then the saturation and the brightness, and optional, the alpha canal value. That defines the opacity of a color. Or you can use the famous RGB color space with red, green, blue, and alpha components. In the same way, you can map a picture to your geometry. Here you see a plane on which we taped a picture. Now we will see some other properties for materials. For this, we have these three spheres and show different manifestations of the properties. At first, I show you the property specular. It decides whether the object reflects or absorbs light. So we can imagine that a foam ball absorbs the light, but a plastic ball reflects the light. The color we use in the specular reflection depends on the material of the ball, but also on the light that hits the object. The intensity of the light spot also depends on the same factor. With the property shininess, we determine the size of the reflection, but for what it is useful. Even it's still a bit time before Christmas, I want to show you two Christmas bulbs. One is very plain and one is very rough. If we see the specular reflection of the plain bulb, it is very small and have hard shape edges. If we see it on the rough material, the specular reflection is weaker, but greater and have smoother edges. With this technique, you can represent rough and plain materials. Here we can see the effect of the intensity of the reflectivity. The selected color blue is reflected from the whole object. The Fresnel property describes the refraction of light on the surface of an object. In contrast to reflectivity, the Fresnel property has a strong effect on the edges. Now we look on the displacement property. In this way, we achieve a material that looks like it has been embossed. So we can give it a structure. We have a grayscale picture and take that to the displacement property. Here we see the pattern we want to imprint. For example, scratches, stone material, etc. can also be modeled with this technique. In this picture, we have used the effect of object emission. That means that a geometry is lighting up, but the light don't hit another geometry. Because that, we get this glowing effect. Now we want to turn on the light in our scene. In the open event, we type this line without the knowledge of the purpose of this line. It gives us a default scene light system that we can use, but now we turn it off and design our own light system. We have five different light system types that I want to introduce to you now. After we know the difference between these lights, I will show you how to implement a light node in a few. So we start with the ambient light. The ambient light illuminates a scene evenly in all points. Therefore, no shadows or reflections are created. As a result, the deep of a scene is missing. This light type can use, for example, for cartoon animations or together with other light sources to bright a scene up in general. Then we come to the directional light. We can imagine this light source as the infinity large plane, so that the light comes from one direction but shines evenly from that direction. The side that is illuminated can be seen well. The side that is turned away from the light source seems very dark. If you want to eliminate this side as well, you can add other light sources. The IAS light type emits a pear-shaped light cone. This is reminiscent of a street lamp and can be used in a scene, for example, for selling or freestanding lamps. Then we come to the OmniLight. With the OmniLight type, the light comes from one point and shines in all directions equally. We can compare this light type with the sun. In a normal scene, you will use it like that. Then we come to spotlight. As the name of this type of light suggests, it is a cone of light that is directed outwards and come from a point, like a spotlight. Now I'll show you how to integrate light sources into your scene. At first, we initialize a new node. In the property light, we have to initialize a new light node. After that, we can define the light type, the light color, and so on. In the end, we add the node to our scene. Because it is a normal node in our scene, we can determine its position as usual. Now I want to show you the basics of animation, how we can objects move. We have two types of movement. A location switch from one point to another point, and rotations. That are the only two movements we must be able to animate. All other movements are combinations or modifications of these movements. So we start with the transposition between two points. We have two functions for this. One is moveBy, that defines a movement depending on a current position. We move some units in X, epsilon and Z direction, and the duration is the time that a movement need in the animation. The second function is the moveTo function. In the parameters, we defined a coordinate to which our object is moved. This function is independent of the current location. Then we come to the rotation. We have two types of rotations, a rotation around its own axis, and the other rotation is around another object that we see in the video. We start with the rotation around its own axis. We use the rotation by function that gets the angle of the rotation and the duration as parameters. A rotation around an object is more difficult, because we don't have a function for that. But we can still achieve this effect by positioning an additional node at the position where the object is located. This help node is the parent node of the object that is rotated. Remember, if you move a parent node, you automatically move the child node too. But if you move the child node, the parent node didn't move. If we want to make this parent node invisible, we can simply assign it a transparent material. Now I will show how you can make the ball bounce. For this, we need an up and down movement. We use the moveBy method and pass the coordinates. Because we want to execute these movements one after another, we build sequences. To this sequence, we pass an array of the movements. We would like to play these movements several times. In this case, there should be no limit for the numbers of repetition. So we use the function repeatActionForever and set our sequence into the parameters. Then we start our animation with runAction. Now I want to show you some demo projects At first, we start with the capsular graph. Here you see the capsular graph, the graph consists of a plane of many capsules. They are animated with the help of a formula. The capsules show the graph of the function, so you can, for example, display and animate graphs. Here you see, for example, the x square function, and you can choose other functions, to example, like cosinus or sinus. Then we come to an example I'm very proud of, the solar system. Here we have the sun as a light source. The light type is omnilight. In the sun are many help nodes, which are related to the different planets. Every planet has one of these nodes as parent node. With the requested speed, we rotate the parent nodes. So it looks like that the planet is rotating around the sun. So we will take a closer look to the Earth. There. Where the Earth is. For the texture of the Earth, we have used a global map. Texturing with images is harder with a sphere than with a plane, because the rounding must be calculated. A world map has already given these calculations for a rounding naturally. This can be seen on a map, for example, in the latitudes and longitudes, because these are applied in curves on the map. With the function that render your current view as an image, you can also render many images one after the other and create a movie with the methods of the MBS AV Foundation plugin. Just have a try. If you have programmed something great with it, we are always delighted about pictures. And now I want to show you what you can expect for the next plugin version. And we have one more thing, or sometimes two. In the next version of the plugins, we add some physics class and a hit test for the nodes. With physics, you can model physical movements. For the usage of physics, we have here an example. We have two pyramids that meet and influence each other's fall. Both elements have the same mass in the beginning. If we change the mass, for example, we have a mass of 10 of one of the pyramids, the place where the pyramids meet is shifted. So you can see. If an object has a larger mass, it will push the lighter object a little bit before it loses its push strain and fall down. Such effects you can make visible with the physics classes. But this is only one of many properties you can set. Just be surprised by the new version of the plugins. With the hit test, you can check, for example, whether you have clicked with the mouse on an object or whether an object crosses a given boundary. In our next demo, you can change the background color with a click. You can an example for the hit test. If we click on the spheres, the background color is changed in the colors that the spheres have. We make the hit test in the mouse down event and get the coordinates of the point that was clicked, and with these coordinates we create a new instance of the class cgPointMBS and check the hit test in this point. We get the result as an array, which we read out because we only need one color, we only need the first element in the array. We take the color from this node and set the color of the background. So you can switch the color of the background. And you see it works very well. If you want more information about SceneKit, it is available on our documentation on our website. If you are interested in tutorials about SceneKit, you can read my article on the Sojo blog or in the XDev magazine. If you have any questions, feel free to contact me by email. So you have here my email address. And thank you for your attention. Have a nice day and stay healthy.